Good morning.
Good morning.
Am I on? Oh, yes, I am. Great. Hey, great to be back in Fulton, New York. I was gone to Boston, Ellen and I, last week, and I went to some continuing education in Boston while she visited with our grandchildren and had a great time. You know what was cool? On Sunday, I peeked in on you. Did you know that? I clicked up the live streaming and I saw your service before we had to leave, Andy and Becky's wonderful sharing of their stories. And you know what's cool about our live streaming now? If you've never live streamed, there are no banners or commercials anymore. If you've ever live streamed, hallelujah. Now, to be honest with you, that costs a little bit of money and it's built into our budget for this next year, but it is so much more of a peaceful, continuous, life-giving message. So I just want you to know what your sacrifice and giving is making possible for us to do that. Welcome to worship. If you're visiting with us for the first time, we do hope and pray that you sense the Spirit and presence of God. I want to invite you to take those attendance pads, which are typically in the aisle, and pass that along, share your name, and maybe get to know your neighbor a little bit. I hope that you pulled out this Thanksgiving card, and we'll keep it for later. I'm going to mention it a little bit more, but it's also for something for you to take home. I'll describe it a little bit later. We want to thank those who give to our web ministry. It makes possible not just the live streaming, but the kind of human resource it takes in Joe, and as well as our website, to keep it all possible. And we're shifting and changing our website so it's a little bit more current and updated. So your giving is really moving us into the future. So we honor and thank the Whiteman's family and honor their daughter Judy's birthday and Debbie Bernard and Anya Tanya and Bill Houghton's wedding anniversary. Tanya and Paul, thank you. I appreciate that. Hey, you know, if you missed it, we had a great time last night at the talent show. Woo-hoo. We had a great time. I'll speak to that. What a great sharing of gifts. So what is this week?
Thanksgiving.
It is Thanksgiving week. And to get us ready, I want us to think a little bit about the practice of Thanksgiving.
Your blessings, you know, the things you should be thankful for.
Oh yeah, like Eskimo pie. I'm so thankful for them. I mean, they're ice cream and cookie put together. Thank you, Eskimo pie people.
That's not what I'm really getting
at. Oh, you mean serious stuff. Like zippers. I mean, where would we be without them? They let us in and out of our clothes, up and down. Thank you.
What I want the people to do out there is just to kind of take a pause in their busy schedules and add up all the blessings, no matter what circumstance they're going through.
Oh, circumstances. Yeah, like the other day, my zipper was stuck. I couldn't get out. I was freaking out, right? You know? And then I thought, what if I was a spaceman? What do spacemen do when their zipper gets stuck? And then I was thankful I wasn't a spaceman.
The lights are flashing, the gate is down, but the train ain't coming up.
Yeah! No, I don't. I didn't have trains when I was a kid. I was more of a monkey bar guy.
I love monkey bars.
I'm thankful for them. Thank you, monkey bar people!
Maybe it's been a while since you looked at your spouse, your kids, your coworkers, your family, your loved ones, and really acknowledged the joy that they bring to your life. I'm thankful for teddy bears, and I'm thankful for my boyfriend who really cares, and I'm thankful for sun and stars, the moon and the sky. And sometimes I'm so thankful that God made a guy like I.
I'm a Jim, you know.
That's it. I think you're getting the hang of this. That's good.
What do you mean?
The song you did, that was great.
Oh, I was just goofing.
Huh?
Yeah, what I'm really thankful for? Mount Rushmore.
Hey, George.
Dave, Teddy, how'd you get up there?
Take the inventory, and I think you will realize how much God has given you, and that'll make you so thankful.
You're right. I am a blessed man. I have so many golden nuggets. I am blessed.
Here you go.
I'm going to go right now.
He's going to go take the inventory.
What? No.
Chicken nuggets. I love chicken nuggets.
I'm thankful for them.
Thank you, chicken nugget people. I'm out of here.
To this profoundly deep celebration of the goodness of God for all of God's people. Turn to each other, greet one another, and say, God bless you. Spirit moves you, and when you think you're done welcoming each other, I invite you, of course, to return to your place. And we're going to pray in a minute, but you know, it's Thanksgiving Sunday, and I think we ought to take time, if you feel so bold, to share who or what it is we are thankful for this morning. And so if you have something you would like to share from where you are about what or who you're thankful for, let's share that right now. Anybody?
Family.
Family, that's right.
Our military,
thank you. Others?
For all of those who shared their talents last night.
All the gifts we shared last night. Rosemary?
I'm very thankful for Pastor Mark because he knew I was very apprehensive about my knee replacement, and he helped me get through that.
That's right, thank you. You said Pastor Mark, just to let you know.
Oh, I'm sorry.
He's a great pastor, too. But yeah,
he was there the last
time. He was, and I was there, and thank you for sharing that. I really appreciate that very much. Others this morning?
I'm really grateful for this church.
For this church, yes. I'm grateful. If you haven't been to one of our Bible studies or our small group gatherings, particularly the studies, man, it is like a community growing in Christ when we're together. And it's very informal, and it's not real, you know, like people put on airs. We are real people, and I'm really thankful for the groups of people that commit themselves to that journey of growth. It's really awesome for me. Others? Yeah. Rich. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Glenda, thank you. Don't feel bad, Rosemary. Yeah, that's right. Thank you. Others? Eugene.
Thankful for my son, Elliot. And I'm thankful on the day after Thanksgiving. It'll be 3 years with me and Paulette.
3 years with you and Paulette. And we're, of course, grateful for Elliot. Yes, Nancy.
I'm thankful for safe traveling for my daughter, Glenda, and her family, which was 5 drivers plus 2 younger, plus a dog.
Yes.
5 o'clock Friday night and drive with your daughters in Texas.
Wow. All the way from Texas with how many daughters?
Well, they had 5. They didn't all go.
They didn't all go, but the dog enough is, makes that an interesting trip. You know what I'm thankful for? Yes.
I'm thankful for my good health.
Your good health. That's right. I'm thankful for that screen right there, because there will be a day when that's going to be a real projector and not our spotted projector. That day, by the way, is coming sooner than you think, because we've already identified what we're getting, and eventually that will be changed. Others this morning?
It stopped snowing in Buffalo.
That's right. Only one person is disappointed in that. His name is Rich Foles. Yes, please. Your husband, your son, and Kim and Marcia Trail. Beautiful. Thank you for naming people. Any others?
I'm thankful for you.
Jan said she's thankful for me, and I appreciate that, Jan. I'm thankful. Yes.
I'm thankful for the great composers of classical music, and especially those oratorios that especially Handel.
For the great classical composers, especially Handel, you said, because boy, you listen to that at this time of year or at Christmas, at Easter, and the Messiah alone will just stir your soul, no matter what your music preferences are. Others?
Being able to help other church members.
Being able to help other church members. Yeah, you got blessed this week, I bet. Huh? Yes. I'm thankful for you and for the difference we are making. If you look at your bulletin, you see that list of some of the things that came out of our congregational conversation a couple of weeks ago. And God is stirring up some dreams and visions that are not about what we do for ourselves. It is about what we're doing to bring Jesus, the love of God, into our world and our community. Any others? What's that?
For love.
For love. Beautiful. Beautiful. Let's let all of that kind of stir us and sift and let's sit in that a little bit for a moment of silence of the things you're grateful for, and then I'll finish all this with a brief prayer as we recognize you, O God, as the giver of all good things. Busy we can get, oh God. And we can get busy between family responsibilities and the challenges and expectations of work and running around to take our kids to the important things that build developmental assets within them, to school, to life, to loved ones who may be sick or infirmed, and trying to care for those who are older than us and care for those who are younger than those of us who are grandparents and are caring for our family's kids because we love them and want them to have the best. Boy, our lives can get full, God. And sometimes we don't know where to push the right button that says, be still and know that I am God. And if it be so by your will, we're pushing that button right now. Just be at peace for a moment and to stop and ask you to let our minds quit wandering for just a moment right now, that we may bathe in your goodness and we may be aware of how much you do provide for us. How much. And it's not about money, but we're grateful for our jobs, for the income we receive. It's about love and it's about grace and it is about presence. Presence. We need to be still sometimes, God, to be grateful, to practice an attitude of gratitude, to take an inventory of all the gifts of life that we sometimes overlook. We're running. So we pause with thankful hearts and lift our hands and our hearts to you in praise and say, thank you, O God of creation, that even in my worst moments, you were there. That even in the moment of my darkest fear, your love conquered that fear. That even when I thought I was lost to hope and meaning and purpose, I wasn't lost to you, and you came close and have begun to lift me and restore me and fill me. We thank you, O God, for the gift of people most of all. Our families, our loved ones, our spouses, our friends. You chose to walk on this earth as a person, to show us how personal your love is for each and every one of us. May we bathe in that fullness and grace, and if it happens, let tears come to our soul. We are grateful, and our hearts overflow. We know those who are in need of healing today, Lord, who need the touch of your healing presence, the great physician to be by their bed and to restore them to wholeness. Send us first, but heal them most of all. We pray for our fellow citizens in Western New York who just were inundated by snow beyond comprehension, and now with concern and anxiety and worry about flooding, which may overwhelm them again in just 4 days. Thank you that we can pray for them. And Lord, when the invitation comes out to some way we can help them with our gifts or our service, Lord, when we find, teach us, show us. Thank you for today. For to live in a country where in freedom we can gather and worship you, proclaim you, love you, serve you, and be touched by you, and be not ashamed. All of this we pray in the name of Jesus, the rock that doesn't move, and upon which we can base and ground our lives. And all the people of God said, Amen. Donut?
No.
Neither do I. Okay, you want it so bad. My. Now, this has kind of been sitting out, so it's gotten a little stale. But what do you notice about this donut? Anybody want to guess? One at a time. Okay, what do you notice about the donut? Raise your hand if you notice something about the donut.
It's chocolate,
got chocolate frosting. How many of you like chocolate on your donuts? Right? It's round. What else? It's a circle. Very good. You've probably been learning that. What else? Did you guys have an idea?
It has frosting.
Again, yeah, nothing wrong with frosting on your donut. And it's brown, but what else do we notice about it? It what? It has a hole in it, which someone had already said. That's right. Now, why am I showing you a donut with a hole in it?
The calories are gone.
The calories are gone, yeah. That is a dream. Because I think sometimes a donut with a hole in it is a lot of times what we are like when we think about our life. Sometimes we think about the bad things more than the good things. Don't we? Oh, I wish I could have this. I wish this would happen. I wish this. And we think more about the hole in the donut than we think about what we have, the rest of the donut. So every time, that's right, the hole is small compared to what? The rest of the donut. So I think one of the ways we develop a heart of gratitude, which makes us generous in so many ways, is every time you see a donut, let it be, or a circle with a hole in it, let it be a reminder that we need to focus less on the hole, on what we don't have, and take time to think about what we do have. Every time you see a donut, then remember to give thanks for what you have. And when you do that, I think you'll discover how rich you are. And I don't mean money. I mean things that really matter, like parents or grandparents or people that love you. Pastors, thank you. Hayden, you are trying to score points today. Because I know you want this donut so bad. Right? We could split up. Do you think we could split this up?
Yes.
Do you trust that my hands are not real yucky? Do you want some of this?
Yeah.
Is there any? I know. If you don't, I'm sorry, I'm just sharing with the children. Okay, yeah. If I'd come up, then you'd be up here right now, wouldn't you? Okay, so who wants a little bit of the donut?
Me.
Okay, and then we're going to pray. So I remember a long time, Jesus gathered with his followers, and what did he do? And there's going to be donut mess all over. So get your hand out, there you go. Careful, don't laugh too hard, because it's falling apart. Who else wants a piece? Okay, we're coming there. We're losing donut. I didn't plan this part, by the way, in case you couldn't tell. Okay, I know where we're what do you say? Did you want some too? Oh, beautiful, thank you. Who else wants some? Anybody else? Bryce? I'll give you that one. Anybody else want some? Are we good? All right. And if you don't like chocolate donuts, I apologize. It's what I got. And I know not everybody does chocolate. So what are you supposed to remember when you look at a donut?
That the hole in it.
To think more about
the outside
than the hole. And let that be a reminder to be thankful to God for what you have. And you'll discover how rich you are. Okay? So let's pray. Everybody say, dear God. Oh, let's hold hands. Thank you. Let's hold hands or do elbows or whatever works. Can we hold hands? Can you hold hands with Everly, please? There you go. There you go. Everly, you want to do that? Oh, thank you. All right. Everybody say, dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Thank you for our families.
Thank you for our families.
And turkeys.
And turkeys.
And potatoes.
And
people we love.
And people we love.
Gathered around. With their heads bowed.
With their heads bowed.
And thanking you.
Thanking you.
Amen. Thank you so much, boys. It was beautiful. And let's read from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 12 through 18. As always, I encourage you to read from your own personal Bible or your pew Bible. Grab one. Mine says 261. That may get you close to the one in your pew, because I know we have a couple of different printings, and they're not all the same. We beg you, our brothers, to pay proper respect to those who work among you, who guide and instruct you in the Christian life. Treat them with the greatest respect and love because of the work they do. Be at peace among yourselves. We urge you, our brothers and sisters, to warn the idle, encourage the timid, help the weak, be patient with everyone. See that no one pays back wrong for wrong, but at all times make it your aim to do good to one another and to all people. And this is the verses I want you to hold on to today. Be joyful always. Pray at all times. Be thankful in all circumstances. This is what God wants from you in your life in union with Christ Jesus. Let us pray. For the gift of this day and warmer temperatures, we are grateful, O God. For the gift of each other, we are deeply moved. And for the gift of your Son and your living presence among us, our hearts could never express deep enough praise. May the words of my mouth and those wonderful meditative tangents you take us on in moments just like this honor you and communicate the fullness of your love to us from you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So really, be thankful in all circumstances? Come on! God just dumped 7 feet of snow on my roof! How can I be thankful when I see the beams starting to break and crack and my family and I have to move out of the house because of the weight load of the snow? Really, be thankful in all circumstances? When I had a freak bicycle accident at a church camp and discovered myself injured in a way I had not planned or expected, my life has been changed forever. And I continue to live with the difficult fallout of that every day of my life. Really, be thankful in all circumstances? Really, when it just takes all I can do to get up on a morning because the depression in me sometimes feels greater than my own will to get out of bed? How can we give thanks in all circumstances? How are we supposed to do that? That's what I want to talk about today. I think to kind of get at this, I think we have to begin to recognize that the heart of gratitude is just like the gift of faith. It is something given to us. It's a gift. Now, we develop it, we nurture it, but when it comes down to it, faith is a gift of the Holy Spirit working in your life and ours, growing it. We can't make it happen. It is God's desire and gift for us. And so a heart of thanks, rooted in a profound awareness of exactly the words we sang for the beauty of the earth and the goodness of God at all times, is also a gift. So that gift of gratitude, and especially that gift of faith, my friends, pray for it. Ask for it. It is, as Jesus said, a treasure of amazingly invaluable price. He says it's worth selling all you have to be claimed by it, because it will change you in a way that will transform you and the lives around you. Now, the second thing about giving thanks in all circumstances, really, is there is a difference in giving thanks in all circumstances and giving thanks for all circumstances. I mean, it's kind of permission giving that we can give thanks even in the most difficult times, knowing that God is at work with us and for us. But that doesn't mean we have to give thanks to God for everything that happens to us. And it kind of relieves us of that delusional thinking we have sometimes that, you know, hey, I believe in Jesus and I follow Christ so I can wear rose-colored glasses and think life is hunky-dory all the time. I mean, we're relieved of that pressure. Because following Christ doesn't necessarily mean it's all going to be hunky-dory. And it's kind of a relief, you know. It's kind of a relief to know that tough things, hard things, difficult things, even happen to good, good people. But God doesn't give up on us. And oftentimes God uses it to work through us. And which of us have not been through difficult times in our lives doesn't realize that in some way they've been the most shaping experience of our lives. They've helped us grow the most. They've helped us mature the most. They've helped us discover God in the most deepest, difficult places. We so often focus on the hole, don't we? And forget to look at the donut that God has given us. So as we think about how we give thanks in all circumstances, here's how I kind of want to jump into this, go a little deeper here, and ask you this question. What is it that we as human people fear the most? What do we fear the most? What do you think? What do we fear the most?
Failure.
Failure. The unknown. Others. What's that? Death. Yeah.
Sickness.
Sickness. What else? I wonder if one of the things we fear the most, at the heart of our striving and our inability to be resilient as changes, we think or feel that we are not enough. That there's something lacking in us. That there is something missing in us. And I think that's a big fear in our Western culture. Because why do we work so hard to gain such a reputation and accumulate so much and some desire to prove that we are enough? Or someone says, I'm going to beat you because since I've been a year old, someone in my family has always told me, you will never amount to anything. So I'm living my life competing and beating you just to prove to you and those voices in my head that I am somebody. And we end up like a squirrel or a hamster or a mouse on a wheel, going faster and faster and faster and discovering we still are getting nowhere. I think the Bible speaks to this. And I think it does it from the very beginning. Genesis, the whole narrative of Adam and Eve. I mean, think about this for a minute. First, God is described as creating all of the world in 6 days. However you want to think about 6 days, metaphorically or literally, it doesn't matter. God created it. And God said after every day, this is good. And then after the 6 days, when everything was completed, God decided to take a break. Remember this, to take a break, to sit back, to have a Sabbath. And as God began to do that, God looked at everything God had created and said, this is not just good, this is very good. Which is another way of saying, this is enough. It's plenty. It's all we need. So then the whole Garden of Eden thing happens, right? And God tells Adam and Eve, he puts some boundaries. Well, first, God tells them that, okay, you can have fruit of all the trees of the Garden of Eden, but the one tree of the fruit of the knowledge of the fruit of the tree and the knowledge of good and evil, you can't eat that. Because if you do, you will die. And they listen, you know, God puts boundaries on it, right? And we get that. How important it is to have boundaries in our life. Some things we should be choosing for and other things we shouldn't be choosing for if we want to live a rich, God-filled life, people embracing life. And then the serpent shows up, right? And the serpent says to Eve, so what did God say about the fruit of the tree and the knowledge of good and evil? And she says, oh, God says we can't eat of it because if we do, then we're going to die. And the serpent brings a temptation and a thought that hadn't existed. The serpent said, God didn't say that. God said, if you eat of the fruit of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, then you will be like God. Now, that's not what God said. But the idea gets entered in. And all of a sudden, I can see Adam and Eve, just like us, going, wait a minute. I don't have it all. There's something missing. I'm not enough. And you can see it begin to... It's like Madison Avenue's first ad through the serpent. If you buy this, if you eat this, if you wear this, then you will have enough. Because there's something in you that says, I'm not enough. That's the sinister part of the temptation to compare ourselves to others, you know. You know, how do we know we're not enough if we don't find that powerful experience and insight from God and trust God that we are enough and that God does supply our every need, that in God there is enough? How do we know? Well, we discover it in looking outside of ourselves, don't we? You know, what are my neighbors driving? I don't have that. What are they grilling their steaks on? I don't have that. What's Beyonce twittering about? It's not my life. What's Taylor Swift wearing? If I wore that, I might have enough. And we think that by getting something else, we will be enough. That is why the practice of gratitude is so important. Because gratitude, my friends, breaks the cycle. It says to us that our peace, our contentment, our lasting joy is not from something outside of us, but from focusing on the donut and not the hole, and realizing that in the love of God, we are enough and have enough. And you think about that, the text, John 3:16, says, God so loved the world, right, that He gave His only Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish, but have eternal life. And how does it begin? It begins with this profound affirmation to you and me that God so loves the world. That means us. Us. That's how far God goes, to love us and care for us. To make sure that we can live with God in forever. I think that's the power of a personal thank you, you know. When you write a thank you, that's why your mom and dad and your grandparents are like, you write that note of thank you for that gift. Or you go up to someone and look into the eyes and say thank you. Because number one, when you say thankful, you begin to say, wait a minute, I'm the receiver of a gift. And it begins to stir your heart to realize that all of life in some way is a powerful gift and we've been graced with it. But in looking someone in the eye or writing that out, you are saying to them, you are valuable. And you are enough. Because you share. You are enough. And the love tank in our hearts begin to get filled up, don't they? And I am, I believe I am enough. And it flows out in generosity and grace and good feelings. But when that's denied us, what else happens? So, how do we practice gratitude? We practice it. We develop habits of gratitude. You know, Thanksgiving is coming, and you got folks coming over to your house, and most of them are going to be family. And guess what? It comes with family, those family dynamics, right? Some of them you love, some of them you just wish you could avoid. But they happen because we get hooked by family. And if you think just showing up on Thursday morning, you're going to go, I'm going to love and gratitude everybody there, and then you get hooked by your family, you're not ready. You need to practice gratitude to be ready for that. So how do we do that? Well, how about a gratitude journal? How about taking a spiral-bound notebook and going to your prayer place, or taking a few moments at the beginning of the day before the kids wake up and start writing the things down that you're grateful for? And be specific. Don't just say Jesus. That's important. But what about Jesus makes you grateful? Don't just say my mom and my dad, but what about them makes you grateful? And avoid doing it on Facebook. Not that there's anything wrong with that, because it's cool to see what people are grateful for. But what happens is when we do this on Facebook or someone does it and we see it, there's always what they call image crafting that happens on Facebook. You know, you can't help it. I want people to see me this way. And we begin comparing again. Instead, go with God in a private place, even if it's the bathroom and that's all you can find that day. Pick out that thing and be grateful. And write it down. Now, here's sometimes we need physical rituals to do it with. So here's another idea for you. Maybe you need to think about doing a Thanksgiving chair. Is it going to work? Is it ready? Let's try the Thanksgiving chair. Oh, there it is. Thank you. I'm thankful for that. It's great. Practice we can involved in our own homes now is place a chair, your Thanksgiving chair, to remind you to stop and be thankful and count the size of the donut in your life, not the hole in the donut. The truth is, you know, we are in the heart-shaping business, my friends. I mean, we to show people that the incredible power belongs to God and not to us. What a great and powerful privilege we have. And the cards that we've sent out and invited you to bring in order to share your commitments, you know, it's not just about a paper. It's about what you want to give your lives to, what you want to give your time, your talents, your service, your witness, and your treasures to make possible. To build an attitude of gratitude in the hearts and minds of others. And we're going to do a couple of things here to end our service. First, we're going to use these cards, and I invite you to bring them forward. We're going to lay them on the altar of God's grace. They represent us, our lives, and I hope you fill them out. If you don't have them, there are some in the pew racks, and if you didn't bring some, don't feel bad, because take one home and mail it in or bring it in. But here's what we want you to do. We want you to come forward and lay down your gift if you can, or bring it for someone. But if you bring it for someone or come forward, or if you even forgot your card, come forward anyway, because we got rocks. We have rocks with pieces of paper on them. And people are going to write for you, what are you grateful for? They're going to write that down on that piece of paper and invite you to take that rock home. Put it in a sacred place or a place to remind you what you're grateful for. And you know, even if you want to take the paper off, it's double-sided tape, and put it on your refrigerator, put the rock in your pocket. So you remember during the day as you reach into your pocket, stop to be thankful and grateful. So whether you have a gift, a card to bring or not, or you bring it for someone else, ask them what they're grateful for so you can take a rock back to them. The other thing we have for you are these Thanksgiving cards right here. And we provided them for you because we want you to use them this week. Every day as you gather around the table, maybe with your loved ones or even by yourself, see how it says, be sure that you go around the table and invite everybody to share something they're thankful for and then pray the prayer for them. Maybe on Thursday as you gather with your family, say, hey, I'll do the prayer time. And this is what I started doing with Alan's family. They first rolled their eyes, but not anymore. Yeah. We go around the table and I say, what are you thankful for? And then we pray the prayer. And on the back of it, it says, pray for one. Is there someone in your life that needs to know that God loves them? Would you pray for one as we move into the Advent season? Pray for them. Care for one. If it's them or someone else, who can you extend your life with to let someone know that God loves them with your life? Who is that? And then share with one. When God provides you the opportunity, maybe it's for Christmas Eve, maybe it's for an Advent service, invite them to come and experience God in worship in church. But most important this week, practice an attitude of gratitude. Let us pray. Lord, we're going to come before your altar. We do this every day, Lord, really, before your altar of grace. Where would we be without you? What you're calling us to be and become, and how you've watched over us and provided. And sometimes, Lord, we ask your forgiveness that we think more of the hole in our lives than we do realize how full our donut really is. And we're coming to lay our offerings before you. Take our hearts, take our lives, and don't let us go. Change us and mold us and shape us, that we may shape with your grace the hearts of others. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The choir is going to sing. I invite you to come forward. Now, if you want to fold your commitment cards, you're welcome to do it. If you don't have a commitment card, as I said, come forward and get a rock, and I'd like our rock drawers, the writer honors, to come forward to, so you can think about something you're grateful for, lay your gift at the altar, certainly take a rock home with you, and then after the choir's done, we're all invited when it begins to sing thank you, if that's where the Spirit moves you and calls you. The gifts can go on either side.
hearts of grace in gratitude to God with the song of thank you.
Thank you.
am so